thank you, Lord. Jesus, you are the way, the truth, and the life. You are alive forevermore. We thank you for your grace and your goodness. Lord, even this week we commit ourselves to you. We pray that you bless us in your word. You bless us with your spirit. Thank you, Lord. Open our eyes of understanding. Let your word come forth to each one of us with power, with your spirit, and even with deep conviction. In Jesus' name we pray and give thanks. Amen. Amen. Awesome. It's wonderful once again to be in the presence of the Lord as we get to hear the word of God. We are reading in Acts chapter 7, verse 9 and 10. Acts chapter 7, verse 9 and 10. This week, we are discussing Joseph. We are looking at the life of Joseph. We started on Sunday. And on Sunday, we are looking at how Joseph is a type and how Jesus is a fulfillment of Joseph. We mentioned quite a number of things in similarities when you study the life of Joseph and the life of Jesus. And today, the title of the message is A Tunic of Trouble. A Tunic of Trouble. The coat, the tunic of many colors that was given to Joseph. It proved to be a coat or a tunic, a garment that brought problems and trouble in the life of Joseph. Acts chapter 7, we are reading verse 9 and verse 10. Acts chapter 7, verse 9 and 10. The Bible says, and the patriarchs, becoming envious, sold Joseph into Egypt. But God was with him and delivered him out of all his troubles and gave him favor and wisdom in the presence of Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and he made him governor over Egypt and all his house. Now, the same story in Genesis 37, verse 1 to verse 4 there, Bible says that Jacob loved Joseph and he made for Joseph a coat or a tunic of many colors. Now, this made the 10 brothers of Joseph to be envious of him, you know, to be covetous, to hate Joseph. For you see, it's not just the colors. The idea of the story is that it was a coat with long sleeves. Now, in those days, the farmers, the carpenters, the workers didn't have long sleeves so that they can be able to work comfortably. You know, the long sleeves would hinder their working. But if somebody is a supervisor, if somebody is a boss to the rest of the team, then he had long sleeves, because that's where they used to put documents. You know, they didn't have briefcases then. So they would carry documents on those long sleeves. And so, in other words, the father giving Joseph this tunic of many colors, he is bestowing on the youngest son authority, administration, a position that is higher than the rest. And so this made the brother to hate him. And we are told, Stephen, making commentary on that story, he says the brothers were envious of Joseph. They were envious, they were covetous of Joseph. Jesus, a man, Bible says in Luke 12, verse 13 to 15, Luke 12, verse 13 to 15, that a man cried to Jesus out of the crowd and he said, command or ask my brother to share inheritance with me, I mean to give him what he's holding. And Jesus looked at him and he said, man, who made me a judge and an arbitrator over you? And then he said in verse 15, very powerfully, he said, beware of covetousness, for a man's life does not consist in what you have. I'm saying this because, like the brothers of Joseph, some of us, we've suffered headache, we've suffered heartache. Why? Because we are busy envying and wanting what is with someone else. No, we want to change location, we want to change vocation, we want to change situation, we want to change our relation. I mean, you want to jump out and you are envious, you're covetous, you are hating somebody else because of what they have. But you see, looking at the life of Joseph, the tunic he had, it proved to be a tunic of many troubles. And therefore, I want to warn you, even as Jesus warned, beware of covetousness. Beware of what you are asking for. Beware of what you are fighting for. You know, be content, be happy, be satisfied with that which God has given you, with that which God has put in your life. You know, they say, the grass is always greener on the other side. The grass is always greener on the other side. But then what we don't know, or what be, people fail to understand is that where the grass is greener, the water bill is also high. So it comes with a cost. It comes with a price. The brothers, they want what Joseph has. And then they threw him in the pit. That is because of the tunic. It's a tunic of trouble. That tunic of trouble, the tunic of many colors that Joseph had, it made him to be put in the pit. Not just in the pit, it made him to be sold as a slave in Egypt. And the brothers picked this cord and they smeared it with blood and took it to Joseph's or their father Jacob. As a result, the heart of Jacob is sorrowful. The heart of Jacob is crushed. Why? All because of the tunic of many colors. It was a tunic of trouble. And I'm saying this because maybe you are dying to get something. You know? That is what happened with this court. Maybe you are fighting and you are elbowing some people and putting others down and gossiping and talking ill of somebody because you want to bring them down so that you can have their position or so that you can have what they have. You are killing, you are assassinating the character of other people, their reputation. Let me tell you, you may get what you want, what they have, but then it may prove to be a god of trouble. So Joseph goes to Egypt. And he's taken by a prominent man, a powerful person with a high position in Egypt. He's put his slave. Eventually, there in Egypt, Potiphar gave Joseph another tunic. You know, he gave him another coat, a tunic of administration, a tunic of authority. Bible says that he was put in charge of everything. Now, the wife of Potiphar, you know, she cast her eyes, her lustful eyes, on Joseph, and she kept on begging Joseph to lay with her sexually, and Joseph refused. Joseph rejected all the impulses from this woman. Eventually, she Bible says she grabbed Joseph and tried to force him, but Joseph ran away, leaving the tunic behind. Again, the tunic of trouble in the life of Joseph. He left it behind. Now, that tunic that he left behind, it became the evidence by which this woman used for Joseph to be thrown in prison. And that's all I'm talking about. That this something was admirable. You say something admirable in the life of Joseph, to his brothers, to Potiphar's wife. But then, it, again and again, it proved to be a tunic, a garment, a position, something in his life that was always producing trouble in the life of Joseph. Beware of covetousness. Jesus warned us. Again, I repeat, Luke 12 verse 15. Beware of covetousness. A man's life does not consist in the things he has. Don't judge people with outward appearance. Some people we admire, if only you can know their frustration from within. Don't judge people from outside. In fact, Paul puts it this way. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 16, 2 Corinthians 5 verse 16, Paul says that from now on, we judge no man after the flesh. Outward appearance can be deceptive. What we see, the displays we see, they can be deceptive. God had to rebuke Prophet Samuel when he was sent to go anoint one of Jesse's sons. And Jesse paraded all the big boys. You know, those who, looking at them from the physically, you would think they are the best. You know, they're the best to be the next king in that nation, in Israel. But God had to rebuke Samuel in 1 Samuel 16 and verse 7. 1 Samuel 16 verse 7. God said to Samuel, "I don't look like man. I don't look the way man looks, or the way man, you know, identifies." Say, man looks at the outward appearance. I look at the heart. So covetousness, beware of covetousness. And the result of covetousness comes from lack of contentment. Covetousness comes from lack of contentment. Now, what is contentment? Contentment, it's a compound word. Content and meant. Content means satisfied. Meant means state of. So contentment is a state of being satisfied. A state of being happy. A state of being satisfied. There's another word that I want to mention. This is contentment. There's another word, contention. Contention. So content, being satisfied or being happy. Contention with contentment, contention, which is the same like a competition. It's contentment is the inner attitude of you are happy, you are satisfied with who you are, with what you have, with what you are doing. You are happy. That's an inner attitude of happiness. Contention, on the other hand, is an inner attitude of struggle, inner attitude of tension, inner attitude of comparison. And that is what the brothers of Joseph were suffering from. They have a struggle, they have a fight within them because they want what Joseph has. Beware. And it comes, that competition comes by comparison. That competition comes by comparison. You are comparing your family with your neighbor's family. You are comparing with your brother. You are comparing your business with somebody else. You are comparing your position with someone else. And you are feeling like you are better than them. They shouldn't be having what they have. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 10, verse 12, 2 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 12, Paul says that we dare not class ourselves or compare ourselves with those who commend themselves. Because they, comparing themselves among themselves and measuring themselves by themselves, Paul says they are not wise. It is foolish. It is stupid to be comparing yourself even to that point of you cannot be happy with what you have. You begin to fight, you begin to struggle, you begin to compete, you begin to have that covetousness, that envy to other people. I had a story of a tear that dropped and was flowing down the river. Then somebody met this tear. No, it had dropped and it's flowing down the river. And someone said to this tear, "Where are you coming from?" And the tear said, "I'm coming from a lady who had been engaged, but before the wedding, she was dumped." Then this man saw another tear flowing the same river, coming down. And he said to this other tear, "And where are you coming from?" And this second tear said, "I'm coming from a woman who was married after that other lady was dumped." So what is the lesson in that story? What is the moral lesson in the story? Is that the one who was dumped, the one who was married, they're both crying. And therefore, it is stupid, it is foolish to be wishing you can be somebody else. The happiest man, it is not a man who gets what he wants. No. A happy man is the one who wants what he gets. The happiest man is not he who gets what he wants. A happy person is the one who wants, who rejoices, who is content, who is satisfied with what he has. Let me give you another story. There was a watch that was serving a certain lady in a city. I mean, perfectly, accurately. This lady, she was never late for her appointment. You know, she was never frustrated with her watch. And so she was very, very happy with her watch. But then the watch said, "Why should I be serving one person? I mean, why am I wasting myself? Yet, I'm so accurate, I'm so perfect. I mean, I serve perfectly this lady." And the watch decided, "I wish I can serve the city. I wish I can serve the whole city." And so it started begging to be a servant, to be serving the city. And so somebody took that watch and put it on the tallest building in the city so that it can serve the whole city. Guess what? The moment it was elevated, it was never seen, it never served, it was never appreciated. It was elevated to obscurity. And some of you are dying for promotion, are dying to go up, are dying for fame and popularity. Be content. You are designed, you are created for a purpose. The watch was not made to be a clock. It was not made to be a clock. The watch was made to serve one person, not the city. And you too, there's a position for you. There's a purpose for you. There's a place that God has ordained for you. The brothers of Joseph, they are envious of Joseph because he has many colors. What they don't know is that that tunic of many colors, it carries with it challenges and problems and trouble. I want to encourage us that we need to be happy. We need to be correct. Paul puts it this way in Philippians chapter 4, verse 12 and verse 13. Philippians 4, verse 12 and 13. Paul says that, and he's writing to the Philippian church. This is a church that used to support him financially. So he says to the Philippian church, I have learned in all things, in all situations, I have learned to be content. And he says, I know how to abound and I know how to be abased. I know how to be full, but I also know how to suffer hunger. Then he says that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That's my point to us today. That let's be happy with what you want. I said earlier, a happy man is the one who wants what he gets. Because let me put it this way again. You may get what you want, but you may not want what you get. You may get what you want, but you may not want what you get. And therefore, like Paul, the life of contentment, the life of being satisfied and being happy with what you have, who you are, where you're going, I mean, what God is doing in your life, where God has put you. It's not something that you just pray and is deposited in you. Contentment is something we learn. It takes a process. It takes a decision. It takes a focus. Paul is saying that, I have learned to be content. Later on, you would say, in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 6, 7, and 8, 1 Timothy 6, verse 6, 7, and 8, Paul would say, godliness and contentment, it is great gain. Then he says, for we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out of this world. And then he says in verse 8, and this is a command, it's not a suggestion, it's a command. He says, having food and clothes, be content. If you have food, if you have clothes, Paul says, and it's a command I repeat, be happy, be satisfied. Don't be like the brothers of Joseph who are covetous and envious of their youngest brother. Be happy with that which God has given you. Because that is good for you. Every good and perfect gift comes from God. That job is good for you. That family is good for you. That position is good for you. So decide to begin to want. Begin to want what already you've gotten. Begin to rejoice in the blessings of God in your life. Because when you are busy wishing you can be someone else, when you are busy wishing you can have what other people have, then you are wasting, you are losing which already God has given you. You are failing to enjoy that which God has given you. Listen to Psalm 84 verse 11. Psalm 84 verse 11. Bible says, the Lord says, I am a sun and a shield. I am the Lord who gives you grace and glory. And then he says, and no good thing shall I withhold from you. So if you're praying for something, if you've been asking God for something, if you've been aspiring to get something and it's not forthcoming, possibly it is not good for you. God is saying, you are my child, you are my servant, I care for you, I'm your son, your shield, I will give you grace and glory. And then he says that there's nothing good I'm going to withhold from you. So if it's not coming, then it's an indication possibly this is not good for me. It may end up serving as a distraction. It may end up drawing you away from God or drawing you away from your family, drawing you away from your rewards in heaven. So don't push. Don't push. Don't force. You know, there are two kinds of prayer. There are two kinds of prayer. You can either be praying, oh God, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. God, your will be done. Or there's another kind of prayer, my will be done. So you're either praying, God, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, or you're praying, my will be done. And if you force, God will respect and give you what you are asking for. But like I said earlier, you may get what you want, but you may not want what you get. A tunic of trouble we see in Joseph. I mean, it was beautiful, it was admirable, it was glorious, but you know what? It brought headache and heartache to the brothers, it brought sorrow to Jacob, it made Joseph to go to prison. But in our reading today, God is gracious. We are told in Acts chapter 7 verse 10, God eventually delivered Joseph from all troubles. And if you are there and you are dying for a certain tunic, a certain robe, you know, a certain coat, let me remind you, Jesus had only one thing. Jesus owned only one thing. Only one thing. He didn't have a house. In fact, every time he wanted to do something, he used to borrow. For example, when he wanted to be born, Bible says in Luke 2 verse 7, Luke 2 verse 7, there was no room for Jesus to be born. So where was he born? He had to borrow a manger. He had to borrow a manger. Later on, when he started his ministry and wanted to preach, he had no pulpit to preach. He had to borrow a boat from Peter to use in preaching. When he was riding to Jerusalem, he had no transport. So what happened? He borrowed a donkey. Even when they questioned him, should we pay taxes to Caesar or not? He had no coin. He had no coin. So what did he do? He borrowed. He said, show me a coin. Help me with that. Somebody help me with a coin. He had no money. When he died, he had no grave. Bible says he had to borrow a grave from Joseph of Arimathea. So Jesus owned only one thing, the tunic that was on his body. And he lost that tunic. So that you today, you don't die for a tunic. Don't die reaching out to a tunic, reaching those tunics of trouble. Don't die for a robe. Don't die for an authority. Don't die for a position. Don't die to be an administrator. Don't. The grace of God is sufficient for you. 2 Corinthians 8 verse 9. 2 Corinthians 8 verse 9, Bible says, but we know the grace of God. That though he was rich, talking of Jesus, though he was rich, yet for our sakes he was made poor. That you through his poverty might be made rich. Jesus had only one role. He had only one thing in this world. A tunic. And he lost it. He lost everything. So that you and me, we can be rich. And when I talk about being rich, I'm not just necessarily talking about rich in money. As much as God would bless us financially, but I'm talking of greater wealth. The richness of the peace of God. The richness of the joy of God. The richness of your relation. The richness of contentment. That's what I'm talking about. We cannot afford to be victims of envy and jealousy. And you look at Jesus, as we finish now. Look at Jesus. He owned nothing. All the people who surrounded Jesus were busy climbing the ladder of materialism, the ladder of vocation, the ladder of religiosity. But Jesus, he had nothing. Yet the crowd followed him. He attracted multitudes of people to such a point that the chief priests were envious of Jesus. Mark 15 verse 10. Mark 15 verse 10. Bible says Pilate, he handed Jesus over because he knew that the chief priests were envious. That's what the Bible says. So just as the brothers were envious of Joseph, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the chief priests, the scribes, the Jews were envious of Jesus. But me and you, let's reject that envy. Let's reject jealousy. Let's reject that competition. Let us reject that attitude of quarreling and tension, because we are dying for what other people have. Let us be happy with that which God has given us. And because Jesus loved righteousness, he hated covetousness, he hated envy, and he loved righteousness. He hated lawlessness and loved righteousness. Bible says in Hebrews 1 verse 9, Hebrews 1 verse 9, talking of Jesus, says, because you loved righteousness and you hated lawlessness, God also anointed him, Jesus, with the oil of gladness more than all other people, more than the Pharisees and the chief priests. Jesus was the happiest man who ever lived. He had nothing, yet he was admired and followed by multitude. Yet he continues to celebrate him even today. So I remind you, having food and clothes, be happy, be content, be satisfied. Don't fall in this temptation of the brothers of Joseph, wanting to kill someone else so that you can have what they have. Because covetousness, the meaning of covetousness is that you want more or you want different. You want more or you want different. Yet God is saying, I want you to be happy, to be satisfied, to be content with that which I have given you. His love, His glory, He has risen from the dead, He is Lord. Every knee shall bow, we shall be glad in the blessings that you bestowed to us, in the places and the areas you planted us, oh God, that which you designed us to be. Father, I pray, may we rejoice, oh God, in your grace and in your glory and your goodness, oh God. I pray for every person who is suffering trouble because of the tunic upon him and upon her. Now I pray in the name of Jesus, deliver us from all troubles. As you delivered Joseph, deliver each one of us from trouble that is around us. And Lord, I pray, promote us. Lift us out of the pit. Lift us out of prison. Lift us out of slavery. Lift us out, oh God, out of men attacks, oh God. And every demonic attack, deliver us, we pray. We pray, God Almighty, may you put us, oh God, in the place that you've ordained for each one of us. We thank you, we worship you, we love you, we honor you, be glorified. For in Jesus' name, we pray and give thanks. Amen. God bless you.